It looked like somebody was bent over and had their head in the window of the deer blind. It either heard me or smelt me, and he pulled his head out of the tent and stood straight up, and that shocked me. They don't make people that big.
The way it moved, almost as if it was gliding across the beach. I've never seen anything move like that in my life. They were screaming at each other in gibberish. It sounded like a language, and they were chuntering away back and forward, back and forward, back and forward. I know what a bear looks like, and there is no way on this planet that what I saw were bears.
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sheriff?
Yeah.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him. Uh-oh.
This is Google. And when we are not spying on you, we are listening to Sasquatch Chronicles.
Welcome to the show, everyone. Thanks for being here tonight. Got a great show planned for you. We're going to be chatting with John. And John had three encounters in California back in the 70s when he was a little kid. Very fascinating encounters, by the way. But as John and I were talking and we spoke the other day, John's actually a real scientist. And I mean, a real scientist, you know, and it was fascinating as we were talking. I was asking him, you know, have you ever looked into Melba's paper, Melba Catchum, with the DNA? And John goes, yeah, I have. And he's kind of started going into it. And I'm at the point to where I know, how do I explain this? When I hear someone explaining the DNA, I've looked into it enough to where, kind of like someone learning Spanish, you know, where you kind of know Spanish, you can kind of understand what people are saying, but you can't speak the language. That's where I'm at with when it comes to DNA. And I asked John, hey, would you come back on the show and kind of explain the paper, explain what she's going on about? And he agreed to it. So it's going to be very cool. I'll be doing a part two for the members where he'll explain the whole paper that Melba put together. We're also going to be talking with Kevin. And Kevin comes to us from North Carolina. And Kevin had one of the most bizarre encounters I think I've heard in a long time. It does involve lights, but it also involves Sasquatch. It's a very fascinating account. If you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. Let's jump into it tonight. I want to welcome John to the show. John, thanks for coming on.
Thank you. Really great to be here.
Yeah, John, thanks so much for being here. And I know that you had three encounters out there in California we're going to talk about tonight. And then we'll have you back for the part two to kind of talk about the DNA paper. If you would, I know this happened back in the 70s. If you would kind of take us back to that moment, kind of walk us into this first encounter that you had. What were you doing and what happened?
And this is back in 1972. I was camping, the first camping trip I ever went on with my dad in an area near Mineral King, which is in the Southern Sierras. And so we're having a lot of fun playing around in the stream nearby the camp area. And the place is just beautiful. And so we had our dinner, and we had a Lincoln Continental, a black Lincoln, kind of like the one that was in the movie called The Matrix. And so I slept in the car along with my mom and my sister, and my brothers and my dad slept in the tent. So I fell asleep in the front seat. And it must have been, early morning. I think it must have been around 4 a.m. I felt the whole car shake. And I didn't know what was going on. And I kind of woke up and looked up and I didn't see anything. And I just sort of lay down again, tried to go back to sleep. But then it happened again. And I sat up in the seat. And right in front of the car, right in front of the hood, was a tall, I now know was a Sasquatch. But at the time, I had no idea. I was 7 years old. And so I just didn't know what it was. But when I saw it, it was absolutely still, like a statue. Okay. And I just totally scanned the face. I looked at that face and I locked eyes with him, and his eyes were yellow and they were glowing. And I could see his lips and his mouth, and he had no expression at all. He wasn't angry, wasn't mad or anything. And I didn't know what I was looking at. I didn't know to be scared or, something inside of me felt creeped out by it. I wasn't sure it was real. But what I noticed was that the fur or the hair on the arm was blowing in the breeze. And so I realized he had to be real, whatever it was. And I stared into his eyes and I felt like I was like in a staring competition with him. And I was kind of almost hypnotized and I couldn't stop staring at him. And I just decided to close my eyes to break the, it felt like I was just locked into this staring with him. So I closed my eyes, and then a couple minutes later, I opened my eyes and he was gone. I tried to go back to sleep. I couldn't sleep very well, but I just kept my eyes shut. And then finally morning came. And so I asked my dad, was that you in front of the car? And he said, no. I knew that couldn't possibly be the answer, but I had to ask. I thought, my first impression was I thought it was a bear. I had never seen a bear before either, but I thought it must have been a bear. And so I told my dad I saw something. And then we heard the neighbor camp nearby, and they were upset because their cooler had been stolen. Okay, so they were looking all around for their cooler, and they couldn't find it. And finally, they found it off in the bushes, like 50 feet away into the bushes. And so, looking back on it, I think it's interesting that none of our camp was touched at all, but the neighbor's camp, their cooler was stolen and the food was eaten out of it. And if it were a bear, I don't think a bear would have taken the cooler and moved it. It would have just knocked it over, maybe. So that's the story. And I was definitely creeped out by it. But once again, I had no idea what I was looking at.
Can I ask you, John, when you were looking at this thing, did it look more human-like? Or did it look more like a great ape? I mean, what was kind of, I know we're going back many, many years, but.
Yeah. It's burned into my memory and it looked like a man. Okay. And it's a good question because he was tall. He was probably 7 feet, but he wasn't old. He was young. He was probably, I would get the feeling of like, he was like a little past his teens. His hair was not too long. But all the details, I could see his lips, and I was really looking at his lips because, I was fearful, a little fearful, and I didn't know whether he was going to be mad or something, and his lips were flat, they didn't move at all. So, and I could see his eyes were very bright yellow, and I could see his nose was long and the nostrils were flared, no real hair on the face very much, but it was kind of like a yellowish skin, if I would say so. Everywhere else it was just hair.
Can I ask you real quick about that behavior? For an elusive animal, you wouldn't think they go knock, shove a car. Yet you hear that in a lot of encounters. People are in campers, cars, and they'll feel the car being pushed in the middle of the night. And when they get up.